It's time for Windows Weekly. Paul Thurrott is here, and I think, Mary, I see her. She's coming. She's running. She's coming back from the Microsoft Teams announcement. She'll have all the details on that. We'll have some more thoughts about Surface Studio. A lot to talk about with the Windows update issues and a whole lot more. It's Windows Weekly next. Stay right here.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for Windows Weekly is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This is Windows Weekly with Paul Thurrott and Mary Jo Foley, episode 490, recorded Wednesday, November 2nd, 2016. Drunken Doughnuts. Windows Weekly is brought to you by Rocket Mortgage from Quicken Loans. Rocket Mortgage brings the mortgage process into the 21st century with a fast, easy, and completely online process. Check out Rocket Mortgage today at quickenloans.com/windows. And by Tracker, a coin-sized tracking device that pairs with your smartphone and keeps you from losing your most valued possessions. Visit thetracker.com right now and enter the promo code Windows to receive a free Tracker Bravo with any purchase. We're giggling, but it is time for Windows Weekly, ladies and gentlemen, the show where we get together once a week, talk about the latest from Microsoft with Mary Jo Foley. You know, it's fitting because her column's at allaboutmicrosoft.com, even though I hear she's getting a little Chrome curious.
a little jamboardy.
A little jamboardy. We'll confront her. We'll have a little intervention in a moment. Also here, Paul Thurrott, that's the deep basso profundo on your left side of your radio dial. He is, of course, the man about town at Thurrott.com. Actually, it's the opposite of about town.
Yeah.
The man avoiding
town,
people.
The town being Dedham.
Thurrott.com. Good day to you both. Hello.
Hello.
Mary Jo Foley was a little out of breath when she arrived for the show today because you ran. Were you at the old post office? Where were you?
No, we were at Milk Studios, which is over near the Googleplex.
What's the cross streets?
15th between 9th and 10th.
Oh, so.
Way west.
The Bronx is up and the battery's down. The people, this is how I know geography in New York. People ride around in the hole in the ground. New York.
That's so, way west.
Like New Jersey west.
I could see New Jersey. I could almost see Alaska.
But can you see Russia? Yes.
No.
I was born on the Upper West Side, you know.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Yep.
West 80th. Upper West Side story.
Yeah,
Upper West Side story. So 15th Street between 10th and 11th Avenue. So
I love that.
Way over there.
That's the, is that the meatpacking district?
It is. Yes, very good.
So is that the place that has the cobblestones on the ground?
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
Yep, right around there. Right there.
And awesome hidden raves and nightclubs and things.
Yep.
And this was an event for what?
This was an event for a product that is called Microsoft Teams, which is Microsoft's Slack competitor.
Oh, you theorized that's what this event was.
Yep, we did.
Did you see Gertie pinged us on Twitter today?
I did. I did see
Who's
that.
Who's Gertie? That's interesting. Anybody I should know? Gertie?
He was the former head of the Skype business at Microsoft.
Right.
Hurdy Gertie, man.
And he had talked to us over the summer. And now I want to go back and look at my notes because I'm curious if there was some hint to this.
Yeah, so it was a one-hour event. Well, 2 hours for us because we had one-on-ones after the event. But they streamed it live. It was Microsoft's introduction of this product called Microsoft Teams. Satya was there. And Kirk Konisbauer was there, who is one of the big shots in Office. And the whole event was just about Microsoft Teams and kind of how it fits into the Microsoft product line and how it competes and does not with Slack. Although I don't think they even mentioned Slack.
Did they say the S word?
Sure. They didn't mention Apple for 15 years. Why would they mention Slack?
Yeah. They did not mention the S word. But it's funny if for people in New York today, the New York Times had a full page ad from Slack congratulating Microsoft.
Yeah. Yeah. Like welcome, Apple did. Seriously. Welcome, seriously. Apple did that. Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah.
You know, Slack is, from my experience
of it. We should tell people what it is.
Yeah, it's really a messaging platform with integrations. And I don't know, I guess because it's popular, everybody says, oh, we're going to do a Slack competitor. But really, it's just a messaging platform. I mean,
it is. Yep.
With integrations.
The Microsoft thing is more than just messaging.
I would presume.
So Microsoft Teams is just messaging. It's a web chat program for Office 365.
So it is a Slack. It is a Slack competitor.
Yeah.
But it's attached to Office 365.
It is. So that's the difference. You know, to me, here's the difference. Slack started as this web messaging program, and now they're building extensions out to things like video conferencing and other things. Right. Microsoft took Office 365 and they said, you know, people seem to like the Slack thing. Let's do a thing like Slack and add it to the big picture of Office 365. So they kind of came at it from two different ways.
Hmm.
Yeah. So maybe you can clear one thing up. I talked to Brad about this briefly earlier. Mm-hmm. There was some confusion over the pricing. My understanding is that basically certain commercial versions of Office 365, you get it, you know, for free as part of that subscription. But it looks like there's also a like a paid tier that is above that, or maybe sideways to that. Do you understand how that works?
So if you have an Office 365 business plan, you're right. Mm-hmm. Business Essentials, Business Premium, Enterprise, E1, E3, E5, and E4, all of those get this Microsoft Teams thing added in for free as part of your existing subscription. So it's not free. Okay. You have to subscribe to Office 365.
Okay.
There's also going to be a version for the academic and education market as well. Mm-hmm. Anyone who subscribes to that plan, Office 365 for education, I think is going to get it too. But there is not going to be a plain old free tier like there is of Slack. That's not going to happen. Okay. So that's the difference. Yep.
Slack's kind of expensive, to be honest with you. I mean, you can't really use much Slack for free.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it adds up pretty quickly.
Cut you much Slack.
And I'll be honest, you know, we use Slack for during the web development. That's what the team in Austin used. And then they switched to what was it? They had HipChat and they switched to Slack or one or the other. But when we use Slack, the thing I found, and I don't know if people who use Slack regularly find this to be a problem, is there's so many amusements available for Slack.
Yeah.
Now, I guess your administrator can cut you off, but I ended up playing Jeopardy. And
essentially, that just keeps going. So it's like a conversation.
Yeah, I mean, it's just like any messenger.
Mm-hmm. You would lose stuff in the.
No. Okay. So it's any messenger with permanent record of everything and a good search. So you can go back, you can find stuff. That's actually its real selling point over, say, just using an instant messenger is you've got this permanent record. So it's like email in that respect where you have a permanent written record, but it flows better than email. The problem is you start integrating all this stuff, animated GIFs. You know, like any time somebody said, what was it? What's the phrase, the Borat phrase? That's nice. Any time anybody said, that's nice.
It's nice.
That's nice. A Borat would pop up saying that's nice. Now, at first, that's very amusing. But the problem is with me for Slack, it was too amusing. It was like, I don't feel like I'm getting any work done here. Mm-hmm. I'm playing Jeopardy. I'm doing animated GIFs.
Yep.
It's as if you used Apple Messages or Facebook Messaging for business. Mm-hmm. It's too, it's gaudy almost.
I know. Yeah. And, you know, Microsoft showed things like stickers and smiling faces.
See, that's what the kids want today. You know what it is? It's the juvenilization of the workplace. And I'm not happy about that.
Although, I bet there's going to be a way for administrators to kind of police this, I would think.
An admin can turn all this stuff off.
Yeah, then you could say, okay, we want you guys to have the group chat. We want you guys to have some fun, some bots, integrated bots and stuff. But let's not turn this into Facebook.
Well, but understand why they're doing this, I think, and I see this in a lot of areas, is that businesses think to attract millennials, you have to give them...
By the way, are the fastest growing part of the workforce.
Yes. I mean, you can't have a business without getting more young people in.
Yeah, they don't understand email. This is the way they communicate.
And I was not being facetious when I said the juvenilization of the workplace. You know, we had Halloween the other day. And I bet this was acted out across the country. Not much work done. It was a big costume party all day.
Yeah.
In fact, we lost business because of it.
And I feel like this is maybe we've gone.
By the way, I feel exactly the same way. It's the
we're old grumpy
cosplay
old
stuff. Everyone's dressed up like Captain America on a June night because they're going to go to some
come on kids
giant
grow
auditorium
up
full of other people.
It's time to face the real work world.
This is a far-reaching issue. I see this everywhere. Like, you guys familiar with the show Tiny House Hunters, right? This is basically a generation of people who will always be siphoning off of other adults, right? They don't buy a home. They buy a trailer that they have to park in someone else's yard. And not
in mom
for
and dad's yard.
Yeah, it's great. Like, it's like this, the continuation of childhood well into adulthood.
And I fully understand, and no need to email me, that we are sounding like grumpy old.
Yeah, absolutely we are. But it's true, right? I know that. I know.
Yeah. You know,
and you, by the way, you can't say no to this because otherwise,
I mean, like, I don't want to dress up like a giant Smurf, so I'm an old guy. I get it, but I still find
I had to. I had to wear a Deadpool outfit. I had to because you have to keep the young people happy or they'll go somewhere. They'll all go work for Burger King and then what will you do?
Right now they have their hands on a knob and they're like, careful, Laporte.
I know.
I can take this thing down right
Here's
now.
Here's the good news. None of them listen to any of the shows we do. So, it's just amazing.
I ensure that.
They go, were those grumpy old guys? I don't want to listen to that.
I know it sounds like that, but and I know every generation thinks the kids coming up are the biggest idiots in the world and they're going to ruin the country or whatever, but my God, are they the biggest idiots in the world? And they are ruining this country.
Mary Jo is recusing herself from this conversation wisely.
A wiser person than I.
So I think Paul and I have both had this experience. I don't know if you have Leo, but I've worked in offices where there's a lot of people around, and now I work at home by myself. I'm way more productive at home
by myself. Yeah, the office environment, it's well known, is not ideal. There are benefits, because collaboration happens when you're with other people, right?
It does.
Right, and that's why I enjoy the work trips, right? So
you have to put up with the nonsense parts, too, like baking cakes for the people's birthdays, all that fun stuff. You know, it's like, it takes away from time.
Yay, Mary Jo's a curmudgeon, too.
I love...
She's just smart.
Be the baker for my office.
Oh, so you had to do it. I think it's wonderful, but it does
fantastic. But yeah,
you could see when you watch
like a forced camaraderie thing, right?
Yeah, because you're thrown together.
I mean, I you have people I think whose jobs are to push camaraderie.
Yeah,
yeah.
You know, they'll send out goofy emails to the team, and you know, like I know I'm the old guy, but I'm like the guy in the corner saying, sorry, I'm trying to get work done over here, you know?
Yeah. So
I feel like that's what Slack is, though, and what Microsoft Teams is going to be too, right?
It's interesting that they're taking that point of view.
Meant to bring people together and let you. Mm-hmm. So the difference, one of the differences is, I think, Microsoft is also kind of coming at this from a work perspective too. Like, hey, we know people want to do the web chat thing and like all joke around and have memes and all this and that, but you also can bring in Power BI, and you also can bring in, Word and OneNote. And so they're really coming at it more from a work perspective, but saying, you know what, we're giving the nod to nonsense conversations when those are part of camaraderie and such. But we're also saying this is how people are getting work done now, and so we have to be there. We're Microsoft, right? I think that's
the
thinking.
You do have to be there. Right. No, right. And for, whether or not this type of thing makes sense to you or I or anyone here, whatever, there is this giant future workforce coming up in the world. And Microsoft has a bigger problem than most companies. They don't just need to attract millennials like any workforce would. This is the generation of people that doesn't even know Microsoft exists.
Yep.
They have to work doubly hard because they're the ones making the software that these guys will or will not use.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, I'm sure they're responding to market forces. This is not...
Oh, yeah.
That would be
for
foolish
sure
not to. And if I were... Microsoft shareholder, I'd be mad at them if they didn't.
Yep. Exactly.
Yeah, you have
so to. Here's, do you guys want to hear some little interesting tidbits out from being there? Okay, so one interesting thing is this whole Microsoft Teams thing is built on top of Office 365 Groups. And so if you know what that is, Groups technology is this thing that Microsoft has across all of its Office suite. It's like a platform technology. And when you join a group, it kind of automatically sets you up. Like you get, I think you get like a OneDrive workspace and you get a lot of things built up for you to have a group participation and conversation kind of thing. So this is what Teams was built on top of. So that's kind of interesting because all the other Microsoft Office 365 products are built or a lot of them are built on top of office groups as well. So this gives you more of an integration across all the different things that are in the Office 365 suite. So this isn't just integrated with Skype. It's integrated also with OneNote. It's integrated with SharePoint. It's integrated with Yammer. So if you are a Microsoft shop that has some or all of those technologies, you can kind of pull those in to your Microsoft Teams interactions. So that's kind of a cool thing. They already have this whole infrastructure built up. They even called Office 365 a toolkit today for Microsoft Teams. So that to me is kind of an interesting thing. What else did they talk about? Oh, I asked them about, can you invite people into the conversation who don't work in your company, right? So say we all work for Twit. We could have our own participation in our own Microsoft team, but they're also going to build this federation out, and they say this will be available by the time this goes generally available, which will be Q1 next year. So that if you want to bring in a vendor or somebody who doesn't work at your company and have them participate in the same threaded conversation, you can, using secure, like a secure federated model. So I don't know if Slack lets you invite in people from the outside or not.
Yeah, it does.
It does. Okay.
Yeah, so all of Microsoft these systems have a method for including clients in a small, obviously you don't want them to hear all the things you say about them behind their back. So in a smaller way. That's very critical because you want client communication as well. Battlecam asks a very good question, though. How does this fit in with Skype for Business? I mean, they already have a platform, right? And Yammer, for that matter.
Yep. So this does fit in with both of those. They showed a demo at the event where they had somebody who was in a Microsoft Teams conversation, and then you could jump from your conversation in the Teams app and go right to video with somebody else through Skype for Business. So you can tie it in that way. On instant messaging, it's less clear why you'd want to do instant messaging with Skype and do this kind of a Teams thing. But the idea I think they have is let people choose which tool they want for which job. And on the Yammer point, I was really curious about that. Like, okay, how do you reconcile Yammer and Skype Teams? Because don't they do the same thing? And today at the event, Microsoft kept saying Yammer is like a bulletin board, right? Yammer is where you go and post something that you want everyone in your company to see. And that's not what Skype Teams is necessarily. Skype Teams is more interaction with one-on-one or small groups or even large groups in some cases where you're having a direct interaction. It's not like a broadcast kind of a mechanism, which is how they're talking about Yammer now. So, yeah. Millions of options, maybe too many. Maybe they're going to need a guide to all these different tools that they have, but at least you have a lot of options.
You should write a book.
Somebody should write a book, Paul.
Who writes books of the three of us? Who is still fool enough to write books?
Right. That guy.
Drinking won't save you now, Therat. It does seem like it adds complexity, and there are a variety of solutions now, and that is
Office 365 is a multi-tendriled beast.
One of the advantages Slack had, I'm wondering if it's going to continue to have it, was its simplicity, right? It replaced a very complicated communication system with something everybody understood, messaging. Mm-hmm. So complexity is, you know, is not, it's not what those kids want.
Yeah. Then you don't use all the other stuff, right? Like if you're...
That's true. You could go simple, right? Yeah.
You just go with Teams you don't do any of the other stuff.
Yeah. I mean, you know, confronted by too much choice, a lot of people just freeze right up.
I know I do. I think Microsoft should buy Snapchat and make it a trifecta.
What consumer brand will they kill next?
Well, you guys remember this, right? Like earlier this year, I think it was TechCrunch who said Microsoft almost bought Slack. They said they almost paid $8 billion to buy Slack.
I don't think Slack was for sale, though. That's the problem. I mean,
yeah, I wonder.
Even at $8 billion, I think the folks at Slack think they've, you know, Stuart thinks he's worth a lot more than that.
Worth way more than that, right?
Yeah.
But I asked somebody at the event today, I'm like, how long have you guys been working on this Microsoft Teams thing, which used to be called Skype Teams until pretty recently? Sure. And he said 18 months.
How much code is shared with Skype?
I don't know. That probably includes office groups. That seems unlikely, doesn't it?
I know. It seems odd. But I asked explicitly about Skype Teams. So
yeah. No, I know. But you could almost picture them justifying it back.
Maybe. Yeah.
Well, we were thinking about it. We've been thinking about it for a long time.
Well, that TechCrunch rumor was, you know, Microsoft thought about buying them, and Bill Gates and Satya said no. Mm-hmm. But Chi Lu, who was running applications and services, said, I want them. I want Slack.
Yeah.
Right.
So
but then he had a mysterious little accident, didn't he?
He did? Wait a minute. What? Is that true? There's some inside joke there.
He had to buy a Slack truck. No, Chi Lu is gone right now. He's
gone?
Was in a biking accident, and he is gone.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Oh, you know, I've met him, and he's a genius, sheer genius. Came over from Yahoo Search, and is widely considered one of the smartest guys in search.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Oh, I didn't know that. So he's kind of recuperating.
Yeah, he's recuperating, and then when he comes back, they say he'll be an advisor, but he won't be back in the same role.
Poor Chi Lu. That's terrible.
Yeah.
All right. Anything else to say about this event? Was it fun? How were the hors d'oeuvres? I don't know.
The food was excellent. The networking worked, which was a plus.
Yay.
They've
had problems in the past, I know.
Yeah, they have. It was a very small, intimate event. We should talk about that. Brad Sams and I were sitting together in the front row, and Brad actually got called out by Kirk Konigsbauer on the stage.
Wow.
So, by the way, I didn't know that until later, but in my article about this product, I wrote, as you may know, Brad Sams has been the primary source of pre-release information about Microsoft Teams. Brad is in New York at the announcement, where I assume Microsoft will present him with a medal of some kind. And they actually did call him out. That's really funny.
What did they say?
They said, is there someone named Brad Sams in the audience?
Brad, is this meet with your expectations? Are we pretty close to what you said?
Yeah. So it was funny because Brad had a mouthful of orange juice at the time, which he almost spit on me, which I was glad he did not.
That's pretty funny. That's great.
Yeah.
That is very funny.
it was a good event. I think it's going to be interesting to see how people like this. And especially, I'm especially intrigued about the bots and all the other integrations that Microsoft's doing. They claim to have 80 some odd integrations already available with this. Right out of the gate, and they opened the developer platform up and said, anybody who wants to integrate in with this, come on, we're ready.
Right. Yeah, I think that's the key. Certainly it is for Slack and HipChat, is integrating. Mm-hmm. You know, when we use HipChat, for instance, we integrate it. I've mentioned this in the ad. They're a sponsor. We integrate it with tools like Panopta, which watches your servers for load and stuff, and it becomes a member of the chat. And then it'll say, hey, your server's over, you know, loaded and stuff. So these are very useful, these integrations. And I think that that's the only thing, the real thing that distinguishes them from any other messenger. I mean, all messengers have text, audio, video, animated.
Well, actually, this thing also integrates into Office 365. So it has all of the compliance and security controls.
Ah, there you go.
And it has some kind of an, you know, admin functionality and so forth. So
that's not to be underestimated because, for instance, when we were using, I can't remember if Slack or HipChat with our team in Austin doing the website, we had to share highly sensitive keys and things, you know, the server keys, the keys of the kingdom, basically.
Yeah.
And you really want to know that that communication channel not only is secure, but will be kept secure. If you're, you know, in a hospital or a doctor, it's got to be HIPAA compliant.
Yep.
Otherwise, you can't
Everything's
use it.
Everything's encrypted in this case. Microsoft has no
so there's
access
a lot of,
to your corporate data.
And there's a lot of trust, I think, I would imagine, in business for Microsoft over and above, say, who these, you know, I don't know, Slack?
I mean, I think that's why this might fly with businesses, obviously. Yeah. It's just another thing you get with Office 365.
Safer.
It's great.
Yeah,
they talked about two-factor authentication, Active Directory, encryption, HIPAA, FERPA, all these standards like that are right off the bat part of Teams.
HIPAA FERPA. What's
like
is that financial industry
list
FERPA?
Of ways in which their thing is recyclable. This is how Microsoft's version of that is.
It's green.
All of the FERPAs they're compatible with.
It's green.
FERPA, Family Educational Rights and Privacy Act.
I'm aware of that because, you know, you. This is weird. I have two college kids. You can't get their grades.
Yeah.
Right. I have a little bit of a problem with that, by the way.
I do. I'm paying for their education.
Exactly. I think the person signing the checks gets an entryway into that information.
You have to ask the kid for permission.
Yeah. I don't know about your kids, Leo, but mine is not, what's the word, forthcoming. He's having a great time in college. He's very open about that.
That's what I want to know. How great a time?
Yeah.
Is it a B great time, a C great time, or an F great
yes,
time?
That's exactly.
How great of a time? I know what kind of time I had in college.
I just want to know how much per grade I'm paying for here.
Oh, you do not want to know that. Trust me. Oh, my God. I once did the calculation on college on how much each class hour costs.
Sure, sure.
And it's just not economical. I mean, some schools it would be, but private schools, it's not economical.
I told him if I had enough money to buy a Porsche, I would buy a Porsche. I don't.
Yeah.
I don't.
Yeah. 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 I'm sorry. We kind of got off on a tangent there, but that's what FERPA, F-E-R-P-A. Okay.
Yep. So if you are an Office 365 subscriber to one of the business plans, you can start trying this out today. Mm-hmm. Like you just can sign in, go into your portal and turn it on and start playing around with it.
Yeah. And it's free, right?
It's if you have a paid Office 365
it's just part
business
of your,
subscription.
Yeah.
Yep.
Now I have the home subscription, so obviously that's
not part of that.
Probably not even available.
It's the commercial version.
Yeah.
Yep.
Actually, no, I don't. They didn't have a home version when I bought it. Remember that?
Oh, so you have one of the small business versions.
I got it when it first started.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
And then later they came up with a personal edition that I would have liked to have converted to, but I never got around to it.
Oh.
See, Leo, so if you were a real old timer, you were there when it was like BPOS.
BPOS. Oh, I predate BPOS.
With your Office 365. I remember when.
I remember when BPOS started. I go
like
back
you had that. To, I think you could pay extra and get your own tenant or something. It was like this crazy, crazy scheme.
Do I go to, can I turn it on an office.com? I guess I probably can, huh?
Yeah, go into
office.com or office365.com. Yeah.
Settings, then services and add-ins, and then teams. That's it.
I don't have a team.
But you have to sign in on that side of it, right, with the work
and
business.
I can chat with myself. Send myself stickers and animated GIFs. What fun. All right, cool. Cool.
Oh boy.
Let's take a break. You guys are clearly tired. After your long
We're
day.
Jazzed about Teams.
You guys are clearly out of it.
No.
I'm pumped like Panos.
You guys have been traveling and going to these conferences like nonstop. Microsoft backloaded the year with stuff.
Yeah, they sure did. Yep.
We'll talk a little bit about the studio and stuff that from last week too, because I want to talk about the studio. I'm kind of getting excited about it.
Yep.
I know. Isn't that weird? We had a long conversation on Mac Break Weekly yesterday about whether Microsoft was stealing a march on Apple with creatives.
Right.
And I think creatives.
By the way, that conversation is ongoing.
I agree.
The tech world cannot get off of this.
No.
Creatives are very upset.
Apple. It's really interesting.
They haven't updated the Mac Pro, the minimum $3,000 minus a screen Macintosh, which I foolishly bought in 3 years. They haven't even offered an upgrade for it.
Yeah.
I think they just today.
But there's a lot of complaints that this thing isn't really even an upgrade for the Pro. It's more of an upgrade for the Air.
For the MacBook Pro, you can't get more than 16 gigs of RAM, for instance, which
is crazy.
The problem is that people look across the river at Windows machines, and there's besides huge variety, you can get a much, much, much more powerful machine for less.
Right.
And we'll talk about that when we come back. But there's lots to talk about still. Mary Jo Foley, Paul Thurrott. We're talking about Microsoft. We're also talking to, as I think is fairly safe to say, a highly technically literate audience, people who like to do stuff online and perhaps are wondering, why is it that I still have to apply for a mortgage with paper and going into a mortgage office? Quicken Loans asked the same question. That's why they created a new product called Rocket Mortgage just for you. Rocket Mortgage lets you apply completely online. No more paperwork, no more going through files. In fact, with a push of a button, you can share bank statements and pay stubs, answer the questions they need. And within minutes, this is the other advantage, right? It's all online. It happens fast. They can approve you for a loan that they tailored specifically to your financial situation. It is the easiest, fastest, completely online way to apply for a loan. And you don't even have to do it on a desktop computer. They have, you can do it on your tablet, on your phone. Right, you don't have to get up from the couch. Actually, the example they show on the Rocket Mortgage site, which is brilliant, is you're at an open house. You know, you just say, sometimes on a Sunday, right, you like to go to open houses. I don't know, I do. And you say, oh, I want this house. Without leaving the open house, you pull out your phone, apply for the loan, and you hold up to the broker and says, "I, by the way, I'm pre-approved. I could buy this house right now." That's pretty cool. Of course, it comes from Quicken Loans, so it's a great product. Quickenloans.com/windows if you want to know more. Equal housing lender, licensed in all 50 states, and MLSConsumerAccess.org, number 3030. Rocket Mortgage by Quicken Loans. Go to quickenloans.com/windows, and we thank Rocket Mortgage for their support of Windows Weekly. We couldn't do it without you. Bow ties are not free, my friends. They cost money.
Well, while you were doing that ad, I did add Teams to my Office 365 account.
Was that easy?
I did. Well, adding it was easy, but I don't see it popping up anywhere, so I'm still trying to find it.
You need other team members to talk.
Well, right, but it's not one of the, you know, the square choices in the main menu yet. Maybe it's something.
Some people are saying that they're turning it on and they're not seeing it.
Yeah, maybe it will appear over time.
Give it time.
Interesting.
Yep.
Terry Myerson sighting. I like the headline. Obviously, Paul wrote this. Terry Myerson, right? Am I right?
This is my terrible impact on Mary Jo Foley.
She wrote this? Terry Myerson, unplugged, but not unhinged.
But Paul added the well.
Oh, my God. This is good. This is collaboration at its highest.
It was collaboration. Teamwork at its finest, guys.
What is this all about?
So last week when I was at the Windows 10 and Surface Studio event, I actually get to interview Terry Myerson there. And so I ran the transcript of my interview this week from talking to him. And so I got a few little interesting tidbits in talking to him that I published. Specifically, I'd like to call out the mobile piece of this, because a lot of people have been asking, what about mobile? What's the future for Windows Mobile? Is Microsoft going to do a phone? So I didn't ask Terry Myerson, hey, are you guys going to do a Surface phone? Like, I wasn't that dumb to try to go at him that way. But I said to him, you know, you've got 1% or less market share now for Windows Mobile. Why are you guys wasting time continuing to update this operating system? And he made some very interesting comments when I asked him that. He said, there are really two things that are unique about Windows Mobile. One is cellular connectivity and one is ARM processors. And I think both cellular connectivity and ARM processors have a role in the technical landscape of the future. So you wouldn't say that Microsoft's going to build something using these, or he didn't even use the word phone. But I took his comments as saying, you know, we're investigating some other kind of mobile devices using ARM processors and cellular that we may come out with at some point.
I don't know if you and I talked about this just before we move on to the next thing, because I actually think that's a really important point. When I read that, I thought back to when Windows RT first came out, and I had written something at that time about my thought that Windows RT was a chance for Microsoft to start over. It was kind of like Windows NT in that sense, a chance to kind of leave the legacy cruft behind and move forward with a more modern platform. The Windows 10 that we have today is not really that platform. It's just, you know, it's Windows, right? And so we have that modern stuff, but we also have the backwards compatibility. And that's the kind of double-edged sword of Windows. You get all the benefits of that stuff, compatibility with all the apps you want, but there's a lot of problems with that stuff too.
Yeah.
You know, and I still wonder if, it's not Windows RT anymore, but what we now think of as Windows Mobile, I guess, couldn't be the basis for some more modern, still be the basis for some future modern platform. We do leave that legacy behind, right? And I think we did talk about on this show the possibility that a lot of these Windows 10-based, other Windows 10-based products like Surface Hub, HoloLens, and maybe even Xbox, owe a little bit more to the Windows 10 mobile part of the what we used to think of as Windows RT than they do to the legacy stuff that we think of as Windows. Anyway, that's interesting. It's interesting that that work is still continuing.
It is. And that they think it's very important, because he also said to me, you know, it's super, super hard to restart. That's why we aren't going to just stop and then say, oh, let's come back and try this again. Yep. So, of course, people who've been hoping for the Surface phone are taking this as a sign that this is him communicating that it's coming. I would take it as more of a sign that they are going to do something in this space with ARM and cellular, but will it be a phone? We're not really sure. He never said the word phone. What else did he talk about? He talked about the headsets that we mentioned last week, too. I asked him about what Microsoft's going to do at WinHack China, which is going to be in December. There are actually going to be two events in December, one in Shenzhen and one in Taipei, identical events.
We should have a Windows Weekly meetup in one of those cities.
Should we? Because we haven't traveled enough this year.
Right.
And, you know, they talked about Acer, Dell, HP, Lenovo, and Asus are making these VR headsets that are going to be powered by Windows Holographic. So he said, you know, when we go there, we're going to talk to these OEMs about Windows Holographic and what we think they can build and how we can help them build it. You know, he made the distinction, you know, at Build, we don't talk about things like lenses and hinges, but that's what we're going to talk about to these OEMs and ODMs who come to WinHack China. We're going to try to get them on board with what we're doing with Windows Holographic and how they can build not just PCs, but also these virtual reality headsets too. So that's kind of what we thought they would do at WinHack, but this is kind of further confirmation to me anyway that Microsoft probably isn't going to be the one to build a consumer low-end VR or AR headset, that it'll be one or more of its OEMs who build that device.
Well, they will be inexpensive, or at least they'll...
Yeah. $299, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, starting at $299. So, yeah. I also talked to Terry Myerson about Windows as a service, and we didn't really come to any conclusions. I said, you know, this seems like kind of a hard problem, like maybe even harder than you guys thought it was.
And yeah, what did you say to that? Because I wrote something about that this week.
Yeah, it's funny. You wrote that too. So he said, you know, we've been kind of weighing what's the right balance between how much do we tell people about what we're updating versus do we just update stuff and then you wouldn't notice it as much?
I said no to that.
I'm like, no, if you guys are updating me, I want to know what the updates are. And I don't think it would make me less or more sensitive to how many of them I'm getting. I like having the knowledge of what you're doing to my PC. But,
yeah,
you know, I said it seems like it's introducing a level of instability, because I've had my PC with Windows 10 working great, and then I get an update and suddenly it's not working as it was before. And I'm curious, like, what happened? What broke? And we didn't really come to any conclusions about how that can change. That scenario can change.
Right.
It's a hard computer science problem, Paul.
It literally is.
It is a really hard one. I'm not even being sarcastic.
I'm not either. I think we would all agree theoretically that this notion of keeping everything up to date is a good one. It benefits the entire world. You by not being out of date from a security sense, are not impacting other users because your computer's not becoming a zombie or whatever. That stuff's important, but it's also not working, right? I mean, the updates are not reliable. There are a lot of people having problems.
Yeah.
There's also kind of an inherent complexity. Remember I went back and listened to it just to make sure that it was as I remember it. That original January event where they talked about Windows 10 being a free upgrade and so forth. And I think they introduced HoloLens to that event. You know, Terry Myerson talked about Windows as a service for the first time. We were all very confused by this, as you may recall at the time.
I do. Yeah.
but the notion was, rather than have all these different versions of Windows out in the world, we want to have one Windows, and it will be easier to update. It will be easier for Microsoft. It will be better for other people because they'll be able to move more quickly and so forth. The funny thing is, if they hadn't done that, Microsoft would have three versions of Windows to support, 7, 8, 1, and 10. But now they have 5 because they have 10. They have 10, 15, 11, and they have 16.07. And in 6 months, they're going to have 6 because they're going to have 17.03 or whatever they call it. And it creates this kind of complexity where you have to come up with a separate version of every update for every one of those systems.
Right.
And we haven't, you know, we haven't talked about the insider, you know, versions. And yeah. It gets to me, it just, it's so top heavy and convoluted. I don't know that the reality of this situation is meshed with the goal.
I know. And I don't know what they can do now to undo it, because once they added the options of, what's it called? CBB. Like there's the consumer branch. Current branch for business. And then you've got long-term servicing branch. So even in all of those, you have people on different versions at different times. So I don't, they must have drawn this matrix when they were thinking of doing this and known this was coming. I would assume.
The support matrix must look like a wall that someone has shot with a Tommy gun. It must just have holes all over it, you know?
I never thought about that, though. Like, when we were even talking about the servicing branches, I'm like, oh, yeah, so this is going to be great. We're always going to be on the most up-to-date branch. But that isn't actually true, because every type of user and every organization is on a different branch. And even some companies inside their company are on, like, three different branches of Windows 10 all at the same time.
And then, by the way, all the other versions of Windows 10, the IoT version of Windows 10, the version that's in the Xbox, version that's in the HoloLens, the version that's in the Service Hub. It kind of goes on and on. I mean, it's you know, you talk about this one platform, which is kind of a neat idea for developers, certainly. It all makes sense until it happens. Yep. Then you're like, well, maybe this doesn't make sense.
Yeah,
I don't know. It's not clear to me. I mean, it does seem, in other words, if it's bad or good, or, you know, how it works out. But I will say that the updating system has been unreliable. I think the data is there to support that. We certainly hear lots of problems with updates. I don't know. There's something goofy about not giving people choice, where it sounds like a good idea, like a helmet law for motorcycles, but you can see where people naturally rebel against it as well.
I know.
Are you saying you don't wear a helmet?
No, so a helmet law makes sense, because you're not just protecting yourself. You have the potential in a motorcycle accident to cause ramifications down the road with other motorists,
I mean, and we'll be paying that kind for of law is important health care for the rest of your.
Right. It helps everybody. And that's why you can make the argument what Microsoft is doing with Windows does make that kind of sense. But I think, I don't know if it's an American thing or, you know, whatever, but you can kind of imagine people reacting poorly to this as when they've had control over this the whole time. In fact, I was walking around today thinking about Steve Gibson like I do every day.
Well, yesterday, you remember he was talking about this. Yeah.
Well, and I thought, you know, Steve is the type of guy who could and should maybe look into basically making a utility. It would be like 32K in assembly language that would, you know, bring back that choice to Windows Update and Windows 10, basically, right? Yeah. I mean, there would be a huge market for that.
I had told, in fact, I meant to ask you, because we were talking yesterday about this whole update issue, and what happened is Father Robert Ballister was in the middle of know-how, and a screen popped up saying, hey, it's time to update. And like, we're trying to do a show.
Right.
And so Steve put this show.
It was like probably inside of active hours, and I hear this from people all the time.
Yeah, it was driving them crazy. But, you know, I remember playing video games and having this happen. This is not anything new.
Well, but a video game is not a mission critical.
Well, and you see it on, you know, screens at airports everywhere. So Robert and I think Steve published a how to use GP edit to fix this policy editor. Mm-hmm. But my question is, if you did the free upgrade, you're required at some point to do this update. You can't put it off forever, right? The idea would be to make it, at a time you like.
In other words, what you want is deferrable.
And deferable forever,
lets you defer non-security updates.
Right.
But the problem, you run into problems where you have like a driver update or a security update, whatever it is, that causes a problem on your system. Even something as simple as, okay, we're not going to let you proactively stop updates from happening. But if you have a problem, and Windows knows this because the events were all logged and everything, reactively, it would be interesting if Windows provided you with a chance to then opt out of that particular update which caused the problem, and then have that update be reapplied when it's known to work on your particular system. Because Microsoft has all that telemetry data. When you have something wrong on your PC, they'll be able to tell if it's just your computer or if it's a certain class of machines with whatever components. And maybe you, that kind of, that's just like a, it's not sophisticated, but it's a step toward the type of sophistication that the system requires, given the complexity of these machines.
You can do a hide thing right now, right? Like you can hide certain updates so that your system doesn't see them.
Yeah, but how do you?
Or not really.
As a consumer, what's happening is this stuff's just updating in the background. Every once in a while, you can go to Windows Update and check for updates manually. Not that anybody probably ever does that. And sometimes you'll see there are updates.
I do that
every
day.
But when you see those updates, you can't stop them. You can't.
So this was a suggestion I made on the show yesterday. I wanted to run it by you to make sure I didn't misspeak. Mm-hmm. If you say that you're on a metered Wi-Fi connection.
Yes, that's one way to do it. Yep.
It won't download and install them automatically because it understands that it's gonna could cost you. And then you have to. You can be proactive. Now, if you do this, it would behoove you to make sure you check periodically. Mm-hmm. This is the thing we also talked about. It's Security Now, right? Yesterday. Right. Security. There's a good reason Microsoft's pushing these updates on people, at least the security updates. The optional updates is another
matter. But so, you know, to use the motorcycle helmet example, it's the problem is the helmet that Microsoft is giving us sometimes causes the accident, you know? And this is... Right. Normally, I would say, in a perfect world, it's easy to look at the scheme and say, this is the right thing to do. Stop micromanaging everything. Computers are supposed to be automated. That's the point. Let it do its thing. But the problem is it causes problems. Mm-hmm. Computers reboot and never come back, or they blue screen and never come back, or they blue screen and do come back, but they're not quite right, like some creature from Pet Sematary or something. Like, I just don't think it's a reliable enough system for Microsoft to enforce it at this point.
Yeah. That's a good point. And by the way, that's not overextending the analogy. A lot of people don't wear helmets. Say the the reason is reduced visibility makes it more dangerous.
Yeah, except in Microsoft's case, it would pop up an ad in front of you.
Anyway, that's a good topic. I'm glad you brought it up because I wanted to ask you about that. Mm.
And by the way, I want to be really clear about this. I don't have the answer.
I don't know 100% what it is.
100% sure that this isn't a viable. I want this to work. I think it's important. And if this could work, this could change things, right? I mean, I was excited about this about a year and a half ago.
You know, what the guidance they give people who complain about this is they say you should set up rings in your company, right? Like, this is for business users. They say have a almost like a canary ring. The people who deploy these things, right as they come down, you check them. How does it work? Okay, then you deploy to a larger ring and a larger ring.
I think that's how big companies work most
of the
time.
Here's the bad news. The version of Windows you run doesn't matter in the slightest. That's the problem. If you go back to an earlier version of Windows 10 or you go back to Windows 8.1, guess what? Everything still works. And once people figure that out, once businesses figure that out, the advantage of upgrading becomes less and less. You know, the idea here was to get people to move to Windows 10 and to stay up to date. But you have all these problems that no one's running these new apps anyway. And then you can just go back to an older version and everything works. And by the way, you get to control the updates again, which is what everyone wants. You know, it's created like a, what's the opposite of a virtuous cycle? it's that thing.
Vicious circle.
A vicious
circle.
Yeah.
Circle of hell?
Rings of hell.
It's a vicious, circle. I mean, I solved the problem with, remember I was having trouble with blue screening on my virtual reality, ultimate virtual reality game machine. I solved the problem by not turning it on.
When I scratch here or whatever.
It works. I did though, because I finally said, this is ridiculous. So I, 2 days ago, I turned it on, did all the updates, notably an NVIDIA driver update, which I think was the key, and it's working fine now. So it was just the anniversary update had, remember I was saying when I was blue screening. Whenever I'd launched the VR stuff, the anniversary update had done something. Or maybe it was a bad NVIDIA driver. It seemed to that's what the blue screen said. It was the driver, video driver. Anyway, all well. So turn it off. You know, you don't like the updates, turn it off for a while.
So you lost like 2 months of usage on the thing?
Yeah, no big deal.
All's well that ends well.
It was only $5,000. It's not.
Sure. Sure. You're the perfect customer, by the way.
Well, I can imagine, you know, if I'd really wanted to play it, that would have been incredibly frustrating. I only kind of wanted to play it, so it was only slightly frustrating. Do you want to talk about a Windows phone with virtual reality?
Why not?
Why? That's what it says right here.
Why not?
I kind of saw the headlines about this at first, and I thought, I don't know. You know, I'm not sure this makes sense. But actually, so it's an Alcatel device. There's an Android version of it already, so they've made a Windows 10 mobile version of it. It's only sold through T-Mobile. I think it's $479, but it's a really high-end phone. It's got an 820 processor, 4 gigs of RAM, I think it's 64 gigs of storage, a 21-megapixel rear camera, which is crazy. It looks like the build quality is really high, but it comes with a pair of VR goggles, right? And you think, well, what does that work on Windows 10 mobile, right? There are no VR apps that I know of. But I believe that I'm going to get one and see what it's like. I think the point of it is that it will work with any VR, you know, videos like that are on YouTube, because those, they're just presenting that in a certain way, and the goggles will work that way. So I think it's kind of cool. And, you know, for the people who are kind of holding out for Windows phone and can't afford an HP Elite X3, which let's face it, is what, $700-$800, somewhere in there. This is a way to get one that is super high spec, and it comes with this kind of, I don't want to call it goofy, but it's kind of cool. It's like a VR kind of a thing. So
it needs to be high spec, at least in the screen, to do VR, because you need to have it. You know.
So we'll see. I'm just curious what this looks like. I like the Google Cardboard stuff. I'm looking forward to the Daydream view stuff on the Pixel. And it seems like this is going to fall somewhere in that.
If you had a Samsung and have used the Gear VR, which I have, it sounds similar. It's pretty cool. Right.
Yep.
it's really a way to sample VR inexpensively.
Yeah, exactly. Yep.
How much is the Alcatel?
$479, I think.
That's good.
Yeah.
Huh. The Idol 45. Mm-hmm.
4S. I did exactly the same thing.
Is this their first Windows phone or no?
No, I don't think so.
But it's probably their first in a while.
And T-Mobile's offering it, which is interesting.
In fact, it's the only place you can get it.
Yeah.
But if you look at some of the shots, it's got kind of a nice looking design. You know, it looks nice. Mm.
And it's the most up-to-date Windows 10 and all that? I'm sure it is. I
mean, yeah, and any Windows 10 mobile phone can jump onto the Insider program, obviously, if you want to get regular updates. If you don't get updated enough, you can. You
know, 5.5-inch screen. Not a super high res, actually, surprisingly, considering it's a 1080p AMOLED. 21-megapixel main camera, 8-megapixel rear camera, 64 gigs of RAM. No, I'm sorry, 64 gigs of ROMs, 4 gigs of RAM, and it supports SD cards up to 128 gigs. Hey, that's a pretty good phone for that price.
Yeah.
Doesn't seem like it has a fingerprint reader.
It does. Oh, I should have mentioned that. There's a fingerprint reader on the back.
Oh.
Like you see on the Pixel devices or the Nexus devices.
I really have come to like that. That's a great way
too.
To do it.
Me too.
And it's a 3,000 milliamp hour battery, which should be decent for a 1080p phone. Mm. That should be enough. Nice.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it comes with the VR headset, right, which is really interesting.
Comes in the box.
Yeah. Because most of these, you know, it's another $100 or something.
Yep.
Let's see. Here comes. So December 15th is, I ordered that Surface Studio on the air last week.
And we somehow have 113 Surface topics to discuss today.
Yeah.
I don't know how that happened. But
it said December 15th. And that is as soon as anybody's getting it, right?
Oh, yeah. If you try to get it now, you're looking at next year. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I am super excited. I don't know. The one thing is that I realize is you need a lot of space if you're going to put it back in that drafting mode. It's not, I mean, it's not because now you move your keyboard and your mouse.
Yeah, you have to figure out the keyboard, right? Yeah. I almost wish there was a more elegant solution for that.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to try it on the air on the round table set because I think it'd be kind of, I mean, it'd be like I'm at a command console, right? I don't know.
Yeah, and I don't think you get like an over-the-shoulder view so people
it can makes see what me wish doing. I were, yeah, right, exactly. It makes me wish I were an artist because I think it would be a, in any event, I know a lot of creatives who use Macs religiously are eyeballing this.
Mm. And it's an expensive way to play Hangman.
But so is, yes, right. Yeah, so is the Mac. although, now that you mention it, it will be the ultimate Hangman.
Yep. Hangman in 3D.
Very nice. Very nice. But And when you compare it to, and we didn't get to talk about this, but the next day, Apple's thing, and they show a DJ using the little touch strip to mix and stuff, and it's like, come on.
I know, it's like this little... Yeah. You know.
Come on. You could have a touch screen and do it on the screen. What is the little...
Here's the thing. I actually think that MacBook Pro interface is pretty cool. I think there are interesting usage cases for it. I think that having controls that aren't covering the content is not a bad idea.
I'm reserving judgment till I use it, to be honest. I can't tell.
Okay. No, fair. But
I can't tell.
But it doesn't excuse the fact that the screen itself doesn't support multi-touch.
There's no excuse.
Well established that this works fine.
Apple can't admit that it was wrong going back years when Steve Jobs said, nobody wants a touch-screen desktop and we're not going to make it.
They make an iPad Pro.
They are the kings of touch.
Yes, of course, this whole thing we're talking about wouldn't have happened without them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is anybody
it's so
getting
strange, yeah. you know?
And the fact that these really are the MacBook Pros are not pro. They're prosumer at best. They're 16 gigs is the max memory. You the video cards that they chose from AMD, now that we're learning the specs because it was a new model that we hadn't heard about, are very underwhelming. You can get so much more on the PC side.
So, by the way, to be fair, that's actually true of the Surface Studio hardware as well.
Oh, really?
Right.
It's not high-end stuff.
Interesting. You're paying for the screen is what you're paying for.
You are literally paying for the screen. Yeah. That's right.
But also, they said at the event that the reason it isn't the highest end is they designed this 2 years ago, and it takes a while to get the components, you know?
Oh, that's interesting. Huh.
Yeah.
Huh. So... it isn't just the Surface Studio, frankly, the app that many Mac creative professionals are looking at. They're looking at better, cheaper laptops. The problem is they're uncomfortable with Windows 10. On the other hand, if what you're doing is living in an Adobe product, it's the same.
What's the difference?
What's the difference?
Yeah.
You know, the Surface Book, it's kind of interesting with that performance base where you get a reasonable GPU for a laptop. Incredible battery life. I mean, obviously the 16-hour thing is video playback, but probably at least on par with what the MacBook Pro does. I think that one's rated at 10. Beautiful screen. Touch, pen, Surface style compatibility. I mean, it kind of, you know, if you're a creative guy in a Mac, you're getting that itch in the back of your mind.
Yeah.
You know, there's no doubt about it.
Yeah, the pen is really, I think, something significant. And I think the detachability, I know this was a challenge for Microsoft, and it's one of the reasons that this machine never really worked very well. Mm. But now...
By the way, just this week...
I got new firmware again.
Which addresses the very thing you just discussed. Mm. The reliability of that detaching and retaching of the screen.
So it's been pretty good. I have to say, we suffered for 8 months, Paul. But the Surface Book,
I suffer to this day.
You still have Hot Bag, don't you?
Yep. I installed this update. I was very interested to see if this solved my problems. And the very first time I came back to the device, it was hot. I turned it on. It booted up from scratch. Everything that was running had gone away.
That's
because
not
it
right.
didn't start. Yeah. It's just, something's off, you know? Mm.
The Surface Book, though, at its price point is really the only competition is a Macintosh because the price point is so high.
I still can't help but wish they had not made it detachable and they had built a real laptop.
Yep.
I don't know.
Yeah, me too.
Really?
And that's the fundamental thing. It's a beautiful machine.
Because of the tippy?
Yeah, it's tippy. It's very tippy.
Well, it's not just that. I mean, imagine if the screen didn't detach, it wouldn't be that thick because there wouldn't be a need for a battery in it. It wouldn't be, the whole thing wouldn't be that heavy.
I have to say, the screen by itself.
They could have that MacBook Pro form factor.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Where it's an ultra portable, not quite an ultra book. And you wouldn't have that goofy, opening when it's closed.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. They at the time said this, we delivered what our fans were asking for. And my response to that is that's not what your fans were asking for. They were asking for an ultra book.
But by the way, that's exactly the complaint Apple fans are saying. You didn't deliver what we were looking for, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
You delivered what a slice of the market wanted. But I have to say, Apple is in the same position any individual, Apple and Microsoft are in the same position any individual manufacturer is in. You can't make 100 different SKUs for every possible market share. You pick a you pick a market and you make what you think is the best for that market. And then the good news in the Windows ecosystem, there are hundreds of other manufacturers who are going to pick different slices. And so you have a, you have an excellent choice. I wish I liked Windows better, frankly.
You should go to Surface.com now and look at the Surface Book and do the little pull down where you can see all the models that there are now.
There's a lot, right?
It's kind of astonishing. And understanding the difference between each as you go down the price list, because I think it starts at probably, what, $14.99 and probably goes all the way up to, $32.
You know, but let's point out, this is these are the first laptops and desktops Microsoft has ever made. And they have, this is now a pretty good looking line.
By the way, absolutely. They're beautiful.
I'm very impressed.
They are beautiful.
To come from zero to this in what, 2 years? Longer than that. The Surface came out.
This is a lot like the next thing, right? They were always like this new company.
Right.
It's been 4 years.
4 years. Okay.
2012, right?
That's how long it takes.
On the fifth generation Pro device, but we're not really because they're waiting till the spring.
By the way, I don't know if you guys saw this just come across, but today at I think it's Adobe Max today.
Yeah, today, yeah.
Dell included, or Adobe, I'm not sure who did it, Dell or Adobe, but somebody included a little video clip of Dell teasing its own version of the Surface Studio.
Wouldn't be surprised.
It is. Yep. Like The Verge has the story up right now, and it looks different from Microsoft's version, but it's got an artist drawing on a tablet, and then above them is like a screen where I don't think you're seeing the same thing you're drawing, but Dell's definitely got an adaptation of this ready with a dial and the whole thing. And I bet all the other OEMs do.
Sorry. Oh, totally.
It looks like it has
exhaust ports on it or something.
Is this an ad before the... what happened? I got a doctor.
Yeah, actually, look at the pictures down below.
Go down there.
Oh, yeah. It's
Look at those speaker holes or whatever those are in the bottom of the device. The round circles.
Right here. Not good.
It like blows steam while you're working.
That's not good. I don't like that. That's horrible.
It's probably a concept design aesthetic.
But what is so he's got a all in one in front of him, and then he's got a tablet, big ass tablet with a dial.
There's a dial.
Oh my God. Well, but presumably this is part of the Windows API, right?
Right. Microsoft wants their OEMs to go do this.
Sure.
Just like Surface.
I was really mocking the dial. I'm starting to come around.
No, I'm increasingly convinced this is in fact the most innovative thing they announced last
week. Very interesting. Because you put it on the screen. Without it, you have a full screen, which is what you want. But if you are working in fine detail, for instance, on a drawing, you can have it in another part of the screen, and it makes it very... You don't have to take your hands off the pen.
You know what it does, Leo? Pen is the one thing that what people do on computers today that's like it's like unimode. It's like when you're using the pen, you're not doing anything else.
Yeah.
What this does is it allows you to do a really fine-grained selection of controls and change things on the fly as you draw or write or whatever you're doing. And I think the potential is huge here because it makes the pen better and more useful.
So is this a concept PC or is this...
It's not really clear what this is.
At Adobe Studio Max, Dell aired a teaser video for an upcoming all-in-one PC.
But there's no dates or prices, so you wonder how close is it, right?
Although Dell
is inventing the future.
Dell is completely capable of making a knockoff of the Surface Studio within within a few months, right?
Yeah. No, I think we talked about this last week. I'd be shocked if HP and Lenovo and all the other major PC makers didn't come out with something that was like the Surface Studio and not as expensive. Mm-hmm. Smaller screen, maybe. Different reduced capabilities, whatever it is, but answering this same need.
You'll create communicate and express your thoughts and ideas as naturally as on paper, but now as part of your digital workflow. Your hands work in unison to capture movement with melodic precision.
10-point touch, the dial.
Separating seeing from doing.
But this is weird because it's a two-screen solution. Naturally.
New tools make it faster, more
it's
precise,
like a giant yoga book.
It is giant, by the way. It's got to be the
you
same size
the
as
best
this.
Professional tool available. Well, here it is. Welcome to your new workspace.
Interesting. Must have blown.
Welcome to your new workspace. Right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, and really, a lot of people have multi-screen workspaces. That's not unusual.
Mm-hmm.
It does solve that issue that I have with the studio.
On one screen.
Right. But no, I have the problem I have with the studio is that, you know, it's modal. So you get it down here, you're not, you know. But that is very interesting. Very interesting. Yeah. So that's from The Verge from today's Adobe 3D Max event, San Diego. All right. Surface Dial is a real innovation. I think that's Paul.
Yep.
October updates for the Surface Book. We did that, right? I got.
Yeah.
What did you get?
Clear,
I got.
Firmware. They addressed some reliability issues with the keyboard when you come back from sleeping having detached or reattached the screen.
Yeah.
And just the general reliability of that clipboard screen attached, which has been, I think, my basic problem and others as well. I know Brad has this problem.
As with many Surface Book problems, though, it's not everybody, because I didn't have any of those issues. Once we got the big updates in July and August, this thing has been very reliable.
But I think that speaks to the general unreliability of the platform, because the results vary so much from machine to machine.
Oh, yeah, there's something going on. Yeah, so I had four or five updates for like Surface Book specific updates yesterday.
Yeah, I did too. Yeah.
What is LTSB? Sounds like a 80s soul band.
So you know when we were talking, we were talking earlier today about CB, CBB, you know, current branch for business. Then there's this other branch called long-term servicing branch.
Right.
That's for people who don't want to get any feature updates and only security updates, mostly in applications where you've got a PC that's acting like a medical device.
Yeah, or it's a server or, yeah.
Right. It's like something that you're not interacting with directly.
Stable branch.
Very, very stable branch. In fact, if you don't want to update it for 10 years, you don't have to. You can go 10 years on the same branch.
Thanks for dragging down the rest of the internet.
I would imagine you get security patches, right?
You do.
Yeah.
Yeah. So this week, Microsoft posted this thing that said, by the way, Surface devices, general purpose Surface devices, are not supported if you're running Windows 10 long-term
That's
servicing
an interesting
branch.
Term, isn't it? General purpose.
I've just been. General Alex just came purpose. In and said we're using LTSB for our edit stations. They've been on Windows 8 since we got them. Mm-hmm. Yeah. We're moving them to Windows 10, so we're building an LTSB image for Windows 10. Because that's exactly. There's a perfect example. The editors are
version.
The editors live in Premiere.
Right.
So they don't want anything underneath it to change. Mm-hmm. Security is one thing, but you don't want any features or app changes, menu changes, any of that stuff. And
so
my
question is, are those any of those devices Surfaces?
No.
Okay, because if they were, guess what? You're not supported, we just found out this week.
Huh.
And
well,
you lose
everything, right? You lose all the Surface stuff.
You do, right.
So I guess I kind of understand that.
I kind of understand it. So a lot of people are saying, well, of course you want to get updates. You need the firmware updates. You need the driver updates. You want Office updates, Edge. But people who are running LTSB know that they are not getting these updates. In fact, I heard from one guy who said, I just got this today. By the way, we have hundreds of Surface machines running LTSB. This is an October surprise from Microsoft, and it is troubling. So they claim they've told people this all along, but they have not. And what does it mean that they're not supported? I asked Microsoft, and they gave me a very circular answer to that. They just said, well, you know, like what we just said, you don't get Edge and you don't get updates. I'm like, yeah, that's what it means. But like, what does it mean that you won't support them?
Yeah, you don't get the firmware updates, right? You don't get, and you lose certain Surface functionality as well.
I know. So If you are in a business, this does not apply to home users, obviously, because you need to be running Windows 10 Enterprise long-term servicing branch. But if you're a business and you have LTSB on your Surface, you might want to go figure this out, because technically you are not supported by Microsoft now. Hmm. Troubling. I like the guy who said October surprise. Really. I think it was.
If I think about like it, Halloween. let's say you have a Salesforce running a dedicated app. They carry around Surfaces. That's the kind of thing that you wouldn't want anything to rock the boat.
Yeah.
On the other hand, if those Surface devices were very unreliable.
Well, that's true.
You would want to get those firmware updates. I think Mary Jo was the one who mentioned earlier the notion of having rings in an enterprise or whatever, where different classes of users are on different servicing branches, essentially. I think if you were going to use a Surface, you'd pretty much have to be on one of the more general branches, right? Just to ensure you were getting those upgrades. It doesn't matter. I mean, a business could still prevent other upgrades from happening on the machine, but it seems like you would want the firmware updates.
Yeah. But I guess you can't get them.
Those are part of the things you don't get, huh?
I believe so. And so, if anything that comes over Windows Update, you don't get, basically. So that includes those kind of things.
Oh,
yeah.
Well. Oh, those things.
All those things, right. So, in some ways you can say, okay, this makes sense. And of course, it's just like one of those like, duh, of course. But other people are like, I didn't know this,
By the way, can we slap this on to the end of our discussion about the complexity of all the versions of Windows that they have to support?
Yeah,
I mean, these are Microsoft hardware products.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's unbelievable.
So LTSB, now you know. The more you know,
the more your head hurts.
Yes.
Yeah. So it's really, you should think of it as for servers and stuff in closets.
It's for specialized devices, like anything that you would think of as like an embedded device almost, medical equipment, those kinds of things. Even point of sale. Some people use Surfaces for point of sale, I guess.
Well, yeah, that's what I was thinking, kind of that kind of situation.
Yep.
Not anymore.
Nope.
I think if you get a Surface Studio, it'd be a great point of sale device. Just put your product on the
sign
studio.
Sign your name in 172 point type over here.
By the way, no more Surface 3s. Aww.
Yeah, Microsoft said a couple months back that they were basically not going to manufacture them anymore. I think they anticipated that happening by the end of the year. And I think it's happened because it's sold out at the Microsoft store and they're out of stock.
Why would you want a Surface 3, to be honest?
Well, price? That's all you can afford. I mean, it's the price. And that's the thing, when you look at...
Sorry. 4G, right, on some of them.
Oh, 4G, that's
right. They also
right.
have that, which is crazy. They don't have that on
I don't
Pro
understand
4,
why they don't do that. That's
the cheapest Pro 4, which is a Core M3 processor, I think, with a type cover, is still north of $1,000. I think it's about $1,030, $1,050, somewhere in there. Surface 3, $500-$600, I think. Plus, you had to buy the cover, and then you had to buy the pen as well. I'm getting strafed now. I don't know if you can hear that.
What, you're playing a game?
No, it's just...
Oh.
It sounded like a military helicopter. The president's landing in my yard.
I don't know about you, Mary Jo, but I think every boy can do that sound.
You get a lot of practice.
That's something, yeah. Something you hear a lot in the workplace now, thanks to our new millennial workforce.
It's like if you're out in the world and you see a plane in the air and you want to throw like a rocket launcher in your shoulder and shoot it down, you think you're playing Call of Duty. That's not a healthy reaction.
So we didn't, with the announcement of the Surface Studio, we did not see a Surface Phone announcement, but it's not dead yet. Right?
Well, I guess, I spent a lot of time thinking about the Surface Studio because obviously my initial reaction to it is this thing is so expensive, it almost doesn't make sense. You know, what is Microsoft trying to achieve here? Like dominance of this tiny slice of the PC market, people who can afford a $4,000 computer. What could possibly be the point of this? And I think the biggest excuse or reason that we can give is that it's aspirational. And you can see that in the Dell device, that maybe it's succeeding on that sense.
Yeah.
But when we talk about like billion-dollar businesses at Microsoft or billion-user products and services, which Microsoft has many of, and of course other companies do as well, you know, there are different ways to get there. With Windows, they did it with one, basically one product. With Office, they did it with basically one product. You know, maybe the goal here is to slice the Surface market into little parts. You know, that maybe last year's emphasis on premium devices and the announcement about Surface Hub and then its release this year was an indication that they really do intend to go after these, I call them niche, you can call them vertical markets, whatever you want to call them, but that don't harm PC makers because they're not competing with anybody here, but still can influence them to make their own lower cost versions and then benefit the entire industry. And if that's true, then all of my arguments against Microsoft making a Surface phone fall apart for the same reason, because this device simply has to be what I would call a 3-in-1 PC, like HP's marketing the Elite X3. This thing that is a phone form factor, but docks or syncs up with a laptop and becomes a computer. And so I guess what I was trying to say when I wrote this was, if you are one of those people that wants a Surface phone, if you're literally waiting for Microsoft to release such a thing, if you take it in context of that, if you take it in context of what Mary Jo got from Terry Myerson last week, I think it's entirely possible they'll release this device. Hmm. Because it doesn't have to sell in the millions of units. It's a PC, essentially. It only has to sell in the tens of thousands or maybe hundreds of thousands.
That's a good point, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, we've been speculating, too, on the last few shows about what, you know, what is a Surface phone? Like, could it right. just be like a mobile device of some kind, right?
I think you said that a couple of months ago, even maybe more than a few months ago, that, you know, maybe thinking about it as a phone is the wrong way to think of it. In fact, when you talk to HP about the Elite X3, they kind of go in the same direction. They don't really focus on the phone part of it, because that's obviously the least exciting part of that device. Mm-hmm. They focus on the other stuff it can do. It turns into a PC through some combination of hardware add-ons and online services. Mm. And I don't know. I mean, it's if HP can do it, why can't the platform maker do it?
Right. I kind of keep wondering if they'll come back to doing something like the courier. Right? Like they killed that idea. Well, it never actually got manufactured. It was just a concept video, but maybe they'll come out with something that's almost like the Surface Mini, but with two screens, and then it's more like the courier. That could be what we're thinking of when we're calling Surface phones
The reason Surface Mini didn't make sense is because it was ARM, and there was
It wasn't differentiated too, right? Like, another small tablet, blah. Right.
Yes, and by the way, today we see no small tablets basically in the Windows space. Jiggering that to be a different kind of device, makes it possible. Mm-hmm. I don't know if they can escape the ARM part of it, right? The phone system tends to be, is literally all ARM today. But that doesn't mean they couldn't make an x86 version of it.
I think if they do this device, it's going to be ARM.
Yeah,
I do too.
Because battery life?
Battery life.
Yeah, because that's what the phone is. I mean, she was just talking about leveraging all of your years of experience doing this thing. I mean, they're not going to just...
We keep doing ARM.
Oh, here's an x86 phone. You know, that would be kind of the worst of both worlds in some ways. It's kind of an untested design.
Plus, they're trying to get people to go UWP, and more developers are talking about web versions of their stuff instead of local apps, you know, like why not just use the web version? So that would you could do that on something based on ARM.
Yep. Right? And I there's no evidence of this, like zero evidence, but I keep going back to the notion that if HP can have their workspace service where you're accessing your own apps in your own data center remotely over the internet, that Microsoft could offer the same thing through Azure, through Office 365. And do that for consumers or prosumers, right? That you could, from a docked Surface phone on a big screen, access the full versions of the Office applications remotely. as a benefit of being an Office 365 subscriber. I've just made that up. It's not based on anything. But
right. We're just talking hypothetically.
It couldn't happen.
Right. Yeah. Right. Nobody should say, I just said Microsoft's going to do the courier.
I did not say that.
I just said maybe that's the kind of thing. Like, I know how these things get out of hand.
I can confirm that Mary Jo just said.
You started a great rumor.
We all heard her.
No, a lot of people will be going, yeah. I don't know if that's really a great form factor or not. It's just that we felt like, gosh, that could have been something.
It was so cool. Remember when you saw the concept? You were like, two screens. It's like a book, and you can write in it. You could, like, have your OneNote or notepad or whatever.
You can buy it today. Oh. I mean, Lenovo sells a yoga
is very similar. Yeah, because you get the keyboard and
I didn't like that though. I thought the keyboard looked too iffy.
Yeah, it's so
the
weird.
Keyboard's terrible actually.
Yeah. But a glass
you could
screen
use it
keyboard.
In you know with another keyboard. Obviously, it's a PC, right? And again, it's interesting. It doesn't work well, but for the same reason that the Mac that touchpad thing is interesting because it gets the thing off the screen. This takes the virtual keyboard and takes it off the screen, right? One of the problems with an iPad or any Windows tablet is that when you bring up that virtual keyboard, it takes up half the screen. Mm. You know, so this prevents that from happening, at least. Yeah. It, as it turns out, it's not very good. But in some ways, it's better than covering.
Yeah.
Did you guys see the blog post from Raymond Chen at Microsoft about why Windows compression is so bad? It's an interesting story. Windows file compression, you know, when you you zip a Windows file, it doesn't do a very good job. He said it's for legacy reasons. It needed to support every chip. You can't compress a file that can't be read by every version of Windows ever. And in this case, the limiting factor was the Alpha AXP.
Oh, jeez. Come on.
A processor Microsoft hasn't supported in years.
Would anyone notice if that wasn't supported?
Well, Microsoft thinks so. But I guess the other kind of point is now that hard drives are so big and nobody really cares that much about
I've been meaning to write this article for a long time. That is an excellent example of how Microsoft's embrace of the legacy is both its biggest strength and its biggest weakness. You know?
Yeah.
Apple very aggressively gets rid of old technology. Microsoft very slowly.
Yeah, but Apple's changing. And I think that that's one of the things that happens is that once you become a monopoly, once you get huge, you can't leave the iPhone behind. You can't suddenly make a massive change in the iPhone at this point for Apple.
You don't want to abandon 65% of your revenues? I don't understand.
Exactly. It's easy to be nimble when you're small, but as you get big, it gets harder and harder and harder. Mm. So I don't blame Microsoft. It's just that's what comes along for the ride.
Yeah.
Alpha, though, Leo. Come
Alpha.
On. Who was using this? We wanted to support our Itanium customers into the 21st century.
He said, one of my now retired colleagues worked on real-time compression. He told me that the Alpha AXP processor was very weak on bit twiddling instructions.
Yep. We all remember that.
For the algorithm, who could forget? For the algorithm that was ultimately chosen, the smallest unit of encoding in the compressed stream was the nibble, because anything smaller would slow things down too much. So you can't really get good compression ratios.
I think the Alpha was the first 64-bit processor that Microsoft supported, right, with Windows. Yeah.
That's right. And the
that's what Dave
basically
worked
in 1992.
On. This is Windows 2000 type. Yeah, no, it was when they did NT 5.0, that's what he was doing.
So for the Alpha,
And you know, since Microsoft's heritage is the enterprise, you can't just
keep
jumping around. No. You know, it's like
you can't have a compression algorithm. They'll create a file that can't be read on some people's Windows.
But nobody's using Alpha.
Somebody
what are you
is
talking about.
Somebody is LTSB, baby.
All right. That's crazy.
A little sweet soul music from LTSB coming up in just a moment. And as long as you hang in there, the back of the book too. But first, it's a beautiful Wednesday afternoon. Time for the Wednesday afternoon traffic report. Where's your keys, my friend? Do you know? Where's your remote controls? Where's your pet? If you had a tracker, you would never lose anything ever again. I love the tracker. I've got trackers on my keys, and I've got trackers on my... I put it in my luggage when I travel. What is it? Well, it's a Bluetooth location tracker. It's very simplest, about the size of a quarter, a little lighter than a quarter, actually. It's anodized aluminum. And you pair it to your phone. And then once you've paired it to your phone, you've got two-way alerts. That means when the tracker gets separated from the phone, you know, if you leave your phone behind, the tracker... And if you leave your tracker behind, the phone goes... Well, not exactly. You can actually pick your own ringtone. But you can also look at a map on the tracker app on your phone and see where your tracker was seen last. So this is great for any kind of thing that you might lose. And they've done a really nice job of the tracker. I've got one right here. It's very light. It has a replaceable battery, which is not true of a lot of Bluetooth trackers, I found out. A lot of them, you have to throw it away when the battery dies. Not with the tracker. With the tracker, you just pop in a new... It's one of those little quarter, less than, like dime-sized lithium batteries you buy at the drugstore, not expensive. And it keeps on going for another year. Bluetooth LE, so that's why you get great battery life. You notice I've got mine printed with the Twit logo. You can this is their UV silk screening. You can also get it engraved because it's anodized aluminum. So you could, if you use it as a pet tag, and you can see it's small enough to use as a pet tag. They have a waterproof cover you could put around it. You could put Fido's name and your phone number or something like that on there. Nice thing is, though, you can see where your pet is at all times. Now, you might say, well, Leo, that's not, I know that's wrong because it's Bluetooth. It's only good for 100 feet. Well, that's true. So you see where the app saw your pet last, but Tracker now has sold 3.5 million devices. You could see the growth from in the last month. They're doing about 100,000 trackers a month now. And that means whenever your device is seen by anybody running the tracking software, it sends a ping to your tracker software saying, hey, I just saw your keys, or I just saw Fido. So it really is the best crowd GPS network in the world, no matter where your device is. I love it. No more losing your phone, no more losing your keys. Keep track of your luggage wherever it is. Go to thetracker.com. You'll never lose it again. Plus, for our audience, use the promo code Windows when you're checking out. You'll get an extra free Tracker Bravo with your order. That is a nice offer. Give one to your friend, your mom, your dad. TheTracker.com, TheTracker, no E, TheTracker.com. Actually, I think if you put the E in, it still works. But that's how they spell it, Tracker without an E. Promo code Windows, your free Tracker Bravo awaits. And we thank them so much for their support of Windows Weekly, making it possible for Paul and Mary Jo to do their thing each and every week, talking about Windows. Let's kick things off with Paul Thurrott and your tip of the week, Mr. P.
Mm-hmm. So this didn't get a lot of press last week because stuff actually happened. But along with the new Surface Studio, Microsoft also released a handful of new Surface peripherals, which anyone can buy. So there's two versions of the keyboard. There's the keyboard that comes with the Surface Studio, which is that kind of iMac looking, you know, rectangular thing, which I'm not a big fan of. But they also have a version of the ergonomic keyboard that I use every day that has that gray melange Alcantara material.
That's kind of pretty. That's pretty.
Now, isn't Alcantara the capital of Chile? Anyway, it's a beautiful keyboard. And with that material on it, it's probably awesome.
I would buy that. That is really pretty.
Yeah, I might buy one myself.
Have you you used that curvy keyboard?
Yeah, the version it's almost exactly like that. It doesn't have the number pad built into it. The one I have is separate. I don't even use it. And then there's actually that triangular gap in the middle. That's actually a hole. Like, it doesn't go through.
And you got used to it pretty quickly.
I love it. I love this keyboard.
I've never used one, but I always feel like, gosh, I'd have to. Is there a learning curve?
Pardon the pun. Yes, there is. Yeah, a little bit, of course. I mean, but you know, if you're a touch typist, you know, your hands fall naturally into this slightly angled position. It's correct. I think it's the thing that's kept me doing this for so long. If I didn't have this and
a large
mouse, I'd be in trouble ergonomically. Like, I'd have carpal tunnel. There's also a Surface mouse, which you can get. And then, of course, the Surface dial, which you need to have a Surface device to buy, but it will work with any.
How much is the dial Surface by itself?
As well. And these things are all shipping next week.
How much is the dial by itself?
$100.
Oh, okay.
$100.
But you get it with the Surface Studio.
So not normally, but I guess right now is part of a limited offer. You're getting it for free with the app.
That is a nice looking mouse, by the way.
Yeah, it's, you know.
$50 What color is Surface Color, by the way?
It's, hold on, it's not gray. I know you think it's gray. It's magnesium.
Magnesium.
Although these things are not made of magnesium. Plastic. They're made of plastic.
Yeah. That looks so much like a Mac keyboard, I can't even believe it. I expect
I know. I know. It's crazy.
It looks like exactly. I mean, it is the same layout, everything.
Yep.
Exactly like a Mac keyboard, except that it doesn't have the Mac.
That's interesting, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, they want you to feel comfortable when you switch, frankly.
Yeah, exactly.
And I might get this. That looks really nice.
I know. I'm thinking about that one myself.
The Melange Alcantara cradles your wrists.
The keyboard I have, you know, I've got the kind of oily wrist stain thing, you know, because I'm gross.
Yeah, I have that too.
I don't know if that would be a problem on the that material.
Yeah. No, Alcantara. It's space age.
I could have it steam cleaned every week or something.
I'm sure you could.
Expense. Anyway, it looks good. because it's the beginning of the month, I feel obligated to mention that Games with Gold has been reset. So four new games for this month. It's so weird. This happens to be a lot. The two games I'm most interested in are actually the Xbox 360 games.
Ooh, the
Monkey Island Special Edition. Classic, right? And then this other thing looks crazy. It's like Far Cry 3. It looks like a 1980s action movie version of Far Cry. I didn't even know this thing existed.
What?
I have to wait till the middle of the month to get that one. But I'm definitely going to – I already got the other one, but I'm going to get both of the 360 games. Those one look really interesting.
Ah, I can't wait. And they're free, right? So it doesn't
–
as long as
the Monkey Island
space.
One is kind of cool because you can toggle on the fly the original graphics and the new graphics.
Neat. Oh, neat.
Yeah.
What a classic.
If you remember the game.
Oh, yeah.
Good stuff.
Very, very famous.
And then app picks, I've got three this week. I had a reader write in about a tool called Win2USB, and it helps you create three different kinds of Windows boot disks for Windows 7, 8, and 8X, and 10. So you can create a Windows-to-go boot disk, right, which is a full version of Windows on a USB key, so you can plug it into any computer and have your own Windows environment. Windows setup disk, which you can get from Microsoft for Windows 10, but it's for all versions of Windows. And then the Windows PE Creator boot disk as well. So this is based on a reader recommendation. I have not yet tested it, but it's worth taking a look at if this is something that you need regularly, which, by the way, I do. The app Raisin Mobile App Pick of the Week is that Paint 3D preview that Microsoft showed off last week, the 3D version of Paint. You need to be running the Windows 10 Creators Update, which today is the fast ring, you know, Windows Insider program. So if you have a shipping version of Windows 10, you can't actually download it. But if you're in the Insider program, that is now available. And then today, Microsoft made Microsoft Flow available. And this is Microsoft's version of IFTTT, right? And when they announced this back in, I think, April, it was only on the web. And then in June, they added the iOS version. And as of today, it's generally available and it's on Android as well. And it works like IFTTT, basically. And it doesn't use as many online services, but it's a way to perform actions, an action or a group of actions, when things change in one or more other online services. And, you basically build workflows with it. So it looks really cool. I've not actually tried it yet, but I'm going to look at this. This looks really interesting.
I use, of course, IFTTT.
Yeah.
But I also use, there are other, programs like Zapier, Zapier. Mm-hmm. And Zapier seems to have more of an enterprise focus, the connections.
Yeah, this one is obviously business focused. Yeah. It works with all Microsoft's Office 365 stuff, as you would imagine.
Is it free?
And then a bunch of third party. I think it is. Let me look.
Yeah, because Zapier, I pay, they have a free tier, but I pay for the. But
it's free for individuals. You get added functionality if you have a commercial Office 365 account, which I do.
Yeah.
Oh, this is what I was thinking of earlier when I was talking about Teams. I thought there was a paid version. It's this thing. So there's actually an added cost plan called Microsoft Flow Plan 2. And I think this is for businesses that don't have a supported version of Office 365. You can actually pay extra to get Flow. But if you're an individual, you can actually use it for free.
Nice.
Yeah.
I think these are kind of really cool tools.
Yeah.
Very interested in them. All right. That means your time is up, Paul. It's time for Mary Jo Foley and her Enterprise Pick of the Week.
And this time, so Mary Jo, I'm going to pay attention because I feel like last time you said stuff that I didn't actually hear somehow.
Well, you obviously were not paying attention to the show notes because my Enterprise Pick of the Week was Flo.
Well, yeah.
But also Sorry. Power apps. No, it's okay. It's okay because we can talk more about this. So power apps and Flo, they're both tools, right? So Flo is what you guys were just talking about, if this and that stuff. And then Power Apps is this other tool that Microsoft has for building mobile apps in a way that you don't have to be a programmer. And that's the same thing that they're emphasizing with Flow too, which is you can be a business analyst, you can be a non-professional developer, and you can use these Power Apps and Flow tools to build applications without having to be an expert in C or C Sharp or any other language. The reason, though, this is kind of interesting. The reason that Flow and Power Apps went GA this week is because Dynamics 365 went GA this week. And Microsoft's strategy is to position this as Power Apps, Flow, Power BI, and Dynamics 365 is kind of like this package. And Dynamics 365, as we've discussed many times on Windows Weekly, is the combination of Dynamics AX, Dynamics CRM Online, and this Project Madeira financials app. So Microsoft taking CRM and ERP and mushing them together into one service. So Power Apps and Flow are related to this, and that's why, as of November 1, Dynamics 365 is on the price list, and Power Apps and Flow is part of all these different Dynamics 365 plans. So that's your little behind-the-scenes story about that.
And your enterprise, code name pick of the week.
Oh, man, we have so many code names this week. It's a code name bonanza. I was telling Paul how we kind of pulled this whole thing together. So we know now what a lot of the code names around Surface Studio are. We had heard Surface Studio was codenamed Cardinal, and I mentioned last week that, or maybe I just told Paul this, I can't remember now, but Cardinal has a lat in astrology and constellations. Cardinal means cardinal signs, and it's a derivative of the Latin word for hinge. So think about that. What we kept saying, why was Surface Studio codenamed Cardinal? The codename Cardinal has to do with hinge. And hinge, as we know, is the biggest part of Surface Studio, like one of the most key
I think you told the story in Vegas, not on a podcast.
Is that when it was? Okay.
Yeah.
I told you this somewhere.
Yeah, you did tell me, but I think you also told the audience our talk.
When we were talking in Vegas. That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's Tom Warren at The Verge was like pulling together all these different code names, and he's like, I think this has to do with Greek mythology. And then I was thinking, no, I think it has to do with constellations and astrology, because here are some of the other code names. The dial device was codenamed Campo, C-A-M-P-O. Brad, I think, was the first one who found that out. The new refreshed Surface book that they announced, codenamed Orion. The keyboard was codenamed Cosmos. So all of these things kind of fit together, right, in this whole constellation mythology kind of family. I don't know exactly what they were thinking when they pulled all these codenames together, but those are all the different pieces that we know so far of the Surface Studio family of codenames. That's a lot of codenames.
It's too bad about Orion, because otherwise it'd all be with the start with C.
Yeah.
I know, right? Yeah.
Cardinal, Campo, yeah. Cosmos, and Orion.
I wouldn't have recognized any of those as constellations except for Orion.
Right.
Yeah. I don't know if Campo is a constellation, but the other ones.
It's Campo, as Eric Duckman says, a codename cornucopia with Cardinal, Campo, and Cosmos.
Yep. Wow. Another C.
Yeah. Like it. Now, have we worked hard enough today that we can take a break and enjoy a donut?
Yes.
Yes. And dip it in beer.
How about the two together? Two great tastes in one.
Okay, this sounds horrible, but I had it when I was in Las Vegas.
Thank you for starting it that way.
It was amazing. And I've heard of this beer before, but I've never tried it till we were in Vegas last week. It's from Evil Twin Brewing, which is here in New York. And this beer is called Imperial Donut Break. So they take an Imperial Stout and they actually make it with donuts.
But not they just say, donuts.
No.
Coffee too, right?
Right.
Save you time.
Insane amount of donuts.
They should sell this at Dunkin' Donuts.
They should. That's actually an awesome idea, but I guess they can't sell beer there.
Sugar, bittersweet almonds,
America
and coffee.
Runs into the ground on Dunkin' Donuts.
Oh, yeah. So they took the Imperial Biscotti break and they added donuts?
Yeah. They brewed it, I think, in the brew, I think they threw a bunch of donuts in is how they did it.
How?
I think.
What? How?
Yeah. And so...
I was
not thinking this was going to be very good. And I'm like, okay, you're not even going to taste the donuts. It's going to taste like this weird bread soaked beer thing.
Yeah, yeah.
But it does not. It tastes this is going to sound so pedantic when I say this, but when you breathe out after you take a sip of this, it totally tastes like donuts. I don't know how they did it, but like you feel like you're drinking a beer, like a really awesome beer.
You're exhaling a donut.
You are. You're exhaling a donut.
Now, See, my temptation would be to drink it and then make out with somebody to see if she tastes like donuts. But that's just me. I'm kind of the Donald Trump of podcasting.
You kind of are.
So you're a beer maker. You can just throw crap in the pot and it will make a beer?
Well, not every time. You have to be careful of certain ingredients, like nuts are hard to brew with because the oil in the nuts screws up the beer many times.
Okay.
But
is this after fermentation or before?
I'm trying to find when they put the donuts in. I can't find it easily.
Because I have never had a good donut beer. And I'm embarrassed to say,
and God knows he's been looking.
I've had a few.
Have you really? Like you've had a few donut beers? Have you, Paul?
Yeah.
You've had a few donut beers? Wow.
Absolutely.
I've never had one.
I'm glad to see that they spelled donut properly in the
they
name
did,
of
with
this
the
beer.
G-H.
Yeah.
Sure.
This is not a light beer, in case you were wondering. It's 11.5%.
Good. So you get drunk on donuts. It's what I've always wanted.
Sugary alcohol.
Yeah.
It was way better than I thought it was going to be.
So wait a minute. Where was this? I don't. Did I?
No.
Was I there?
It was
for
one
this?
Night. What? No, you weren't there. One night I went to one of the restaurants there, and I'm like, I need one more beer for the day, and this is what I had.
Oh boy.
Yeah. Yeah.
Sounds good.
I wonder if I can last Mary Jo one night on this trip.
I'll get some.
She's often more willing to stay up and drink than I am.
Am I?
She takes her business seriously, and her business
is a professional.
Beer.
She's good at what she does.
By the way,
we should talk about upcoming.
I was just going to say Facebook's results are out. 1.76 billion monthly active users.
Wow.
They beat the street on both profits, revenue, and user growth. So very, very good quarter for Facebook. And once again, it seems like they've licked mobile advertising. We'll talk more about it in just a bit on This Week in Google. And, of course, this afternoon on Tech News Today. Qualcomm and Facebook results out today. Qualcomm also beat the street, by the way. Now, you guys, you never stop. The peripatetic Mary Jo Foley and Paul Thurrott. What's up?
Paul should talk about this. It's your company's event.
What are we talking about?
Read the notes.
Unity Connect. Yeah.
So,
Unity Connect,
right? Not next week, right? Or is it next week? It is next week.
It's November.
No, it's actually the week after that. So,
next week is
late
November
next
9th.
Week, we're flying to Amsterdam. And then, so I guess 2 weeks from now, we will be in Amsterdam.
Yeah.
And we haven't figured out the venue yet, but we're going to do a live show from Amsterdam. And so we should know by next week, right? I think we should.
That would be fun.
Try to figure this out. So if you're in the area and you want to come down, I think that will be possible. And I guess we'll have like a meetup around the show kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So on Wednesday, November, 16th? Yeah. So the show will be 8 p.m. local time in Amsterdam, right? And then we can hang out for a while. So I think we'll do something that night. And then, well, separately, there's a share pint event, right, happening at the show. But I don't know if that's that Thursday or Friday night, maybe.
Yeah, I can't remember which night it is, but we'll be there.
And that's in Harlem, and we'll be there for that as well.
Harlem is not right in Amsterdam. That's like half an hour, 45 minutes away. I mean, it's...
Yeah, so it's not even that far, actually. Oh, like, and by the way, I received a grumbly email from someone because we referred to Harlem as a suburb of Amsterdam, right? Harlem is, of course, a city unto itself, but it is right next to Harlem. I mean, 20 minutes outside of Boston is a suburb of Boston. I wasn't trying to downplay the significance of Harlem. It's a beautiful place. We're happy to be going.
Paul, again, with offending the Dutch.
Another international incident.
Exactly.
When will you ever learn?
Trip, another international incident.
Good.
But next week we'll be here. Next week we'll both be home at our usual locations.
This will be the post-election episode next week.
Yep.
And we'll the post-second Tuesday. Yeah, I'll either be hungover or really kind of depressive.
It'll be an extreme of one kind or another. Let's put it that way.
And at this point, it could go either way, I really think.
Yep.
Good. We'll talk. Actually, I might not. It's possible I'll even not even be here. I'll be in Bolivia. You just don't know. You really don't know.
Sure. I'll be in my new home in Toronto.
I have been invited. Paul Thurrott is at Thurrott.com. Wherever he lives, you know, in real life, you can always find him at Thurrott.com. Become a premium member, as I have, and read all of the stuff there. Thurrott. Do you do a piece a day for the premium?
No, I shoot for 3 or 4 a week. So not quite every day.
Yeah. I'm glad I subscribed, actually. There's lots of good stuff in there. You can also find his books at leanpub.com. You'll find Mary Jo Foley on the web at allaboutmicrosoft.com. That's her ZDNet blog. And you'll find both of them in Harlem.
Not the one in New York.
In a couple of weeks.
Right. Yeah. Not that one.
Yeah. They're going way uptown. Yep. Way uptown from Amsterdam. thank you, everybody, for joining us. We do Windows Weekly every Wednesday at 11 a.m. Pacific. That's 2 p.m. Eastern, 1800 UTC. If you want to stop by, do it live. Actually, this is that one time, two times a year I have to do this. Many of you have already entered, left summertime and entered standard time. We have not yet, so you probably noticed when you, like if you're in Germany and you tuned in, that we're at the wrong time. Our summertime ends Sunday. So,
which is how long has that been the case?
No, that was just a few years ago.
Yeah,
by executive order.
My car
order.
Is off by a year, and my wife informed me. I know it was because my car is old enough that it's programmed for the previous switchover.
Anyway, that means that we will be -8. So the new time.
So this is almost as confusing as Windows serviceability.
I know.
Yeah. We're setting our clock back, so we're now 8 hours.
If you're on the long-term time zone
off of GMT
branch.
We're 8 hours off of GMT. So that means we'll be 11 a.m. Pacific, 2 p.m. Eastern, 1900 UTC, okay, starting next week. And the reason I do the UTC is not because I know you live in universal time, but because you can probably figure out, given your offset, what time that is in your neck of the woods.
God knows I can't.
Somebody's saying, why don't we just split the difference and roll it back half an hour and leave it? Right. I'd be okay with that.
Yep.
By the way, this just in from the Telegraph, they have invented deep fried beer in Texas.
Ooh.
Stay tuned for deets.
Thanks. It's like that gum that squirts in the middle. It's like a little beer surprise.
Thanks, everybody. Have a great week, and we will see you next time at our new time on Windows Weekly.